your Bibles and turn with me to John chapter 1. John gospel is unique. John shares with us a lot of things. In fact, most of what he says is not recorded in the synoptic gospel of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. I hope you were here for Sunday school. If you were not, I want you to remember Sunday school at 10, and our Sunday school lesson this morning makes us realize where we at in the world that we're in. There's a lot of sin. And as Wayne so ably pointed out, Jesus died for it. You and I, most of us, I've read the last chapter. God wins. It doesn't matter how bad the world gets. Remember, God wins. Always. And let us walk with him, hold to his unchanging hand. John's Gospel, chapter 1. Are you ready? Say amen.
Amen.
I want to read verses 1 through 5, then verse 14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Or literally, the darkness cannot overcome the light. Verse 14. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. When I consider the world that we live in and the problems that face all of us and the sin that is all around us, my desire is to look at the Lord, to see the Lord high and lifted up, to see him exalted, to see him as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I think of Isaiah in the temple vision. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died, which was a good king, and Isaiah was familiar with his lip. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple, and the doors of the pole trembled or shook. And I heard the seraphim crying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." In the world that I live in the world that you live in, God help us never to lose sight of the holiness of God. Thank you, choir. Never lose sight of the holiness and the exaltation of the Lord our God and his Son, Jesus Christ. Isaiah saw the Lord high and lifted up. How do you see the Lord? You understand, and I understand, there's a lot of things in our world that people worship, but there's nothing like God. There's nothing like his Son, who loves us with an everlasting love. There's nothing like God with us in the days of grace in the person of the Holy Spirit. And John says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. If you were here a couple of weeks ago, I preached on this verse, basically. God knows no beginning, and he knows no ending. Jesus, our eternal high priest after the order of Melchizedek, and you know the reason that is pointed out, because they don't know the genealogy of Melchizedek. all these others that were leaders, they come and go in the Old Testament, leading in the area of priest and priesthood. But Jesus ever lived to make intercession for us. We don't have to change priests. We have one that lived forever. He knew you when he heard your first prayer. He will be there when you take your last breath. Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was God. Jesus has always been God. Now I want you to think with me on other verses down in here. God as creator. You read Genesis and you're made aware in the beginning God. And God spoke and this came into existence. And God spoke and something else came into existence. And God spoke and something else came to existence. Just by his spoken word. We see creation. We love the mountains. We love the beaches. Love the forests and the rivers and the fertile plains. Paul says, well, what about, you know, we say, what about those who have never heard? And Paul said to the church at Rome, man is without excuse because the thing that God had made that we see makes us know there's something that we cannot see, and that is him. And that is life, and that is love, and that is what he does for us. Things invisible that we cannot see. The psalmist joins in with the writer of Genesis to proclaim God as creator, and everywhere we look, we are made aware of his creation. John says, remember the word. John says, he is the creator. God created. And in verse 2, it says the Spirit of God moved. And in verse 26 of Genesis 1, it says, let us make. All things are made in the universe by his spoken word. The Spanish language has a word that I like. The word is cosmos, and it doesn't mean just the earth. To them, when they say cosmos, it means everything. The earth, the planets, the stars, the moon, the sun, cosmos. God made it all. And so it is, the Revelator says that he is worthy of our adoration, worthy of our praise, because all things should give honor and praise and adoration to his name. Paul shared with the church at Colossae that he made things for his enjoyment, as we would say, for him, for himself. And of course, he made man, and we ought to love him and declare his creation. John declares, the Word is our creator. There is no higher proof of omnipotence, of divinity, of having all power. Now, I want you to take time to look with me at five things of creation. The universe. Not just the earth, the universe. The other day I saw this test. Bible test, it said. And one of the things, which planet is closer to the sun? I thought, that's Bible? Yeah. He made it all. He made it all in the universe. I have, or was given, a subscription to National Geographic magazine when I was very young. And I've been reading it ever since. And I usually try to read it from cover to cover. And once in a while, there is an article in National Geographic about the Hubble telescope. And now there's articles in there about the Willis telescope. You know, we stand here with our feet on the ground, and we look out in the universe day or night, and we see something. But these telescopes that man has made is out there past the atmosphere where there's no interruption, and they can see deep into space. They see stars being born and stars dying. Listen. It says, God Almighty, He knows the stars by name. He knows the stars by name, and we see the sky. My son lived in Atlanta for several years, and one evening he was home, and we walked out, and I live in the country, in the woods. And we walked out, and he said, "Dad, I forgot how many stars and how beautiful the night sky is." God, the creator of the universe. God made man. Yeah. From the dust of his earth. If you ever get filled with pride, just think about what you're made out of, okay? Just think about what you're made out of. Dust of the earth. But the touch of the Master's hand, He breathed into that dust the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Now hear the reality. That dust, you, me, or whoever it is, will live from the moment of conception for all eternity, somewhere, because God Almighty breathed into us the breath of life. And He put man in the garden to dress it and to keep it. Which brings to my mind what Paul says, if a person won't work, don't let him eat. Okay. Man made to work. He made man with a spoken word. I read this interesting article this week, written by a Catholic cardinal, I think, a bishop or something anyway, on up the line in the Catholic Church. And he was talking about the family. God saw it wasn't good for man to be alone, and He made for him a helpmate. Yeah. Thank you all for your help. Gracious a lot. There's more to do than one can do, okay? You can work day and night, and there's still more to do. So you need, God saw we needed a helpmate. And God made a family. That's what this Catholic writer was speaking about, the family. Man, woman, in the family. We live in a distorted world. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. What did He build? What did He create? What was His intention? For us to replenish the earth and train up our children to love Him and to serve Him and to walk with Him. God also created nations. And He created government. Yeah. Paul said in 13th chapter of Romans, we are to be obedient to the government. And Paul lived in a time when the Roman government was authority. And it wasn't easy for folks to be Christians. He said we're to live. We live in a free society. Okay? Now, all it takes for evil to triumph is for godly people to do nothing. Understand? All it takes for evil to triumph is for godly people to do nothing. There's a lot of wickedness in our world. God help us to be light and to be salt. And living in a democratic society, we have responsibility to all of humanity, to our nation, to the world. God made government, and we have the privilege to be involved. God created the church, okay? The church is not some brainchild of an ancient man or some brainchild of a modern man. Now, we do church different, I guarantee you, down through the centuries. I have been in enough churches to know that every church is like a family, is a little bit different, you know? When I was growing up, we sit down at the table, all of us were there. We had prayer before we moved to get food or anything else, you know? In my house, I don't know, we develop the thing, everybody serves the plate, and then we get quiet, and we have a blessing then. Now, all churches are different. Thank you for the worship experience that is brought out in this church and your exaltation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Peter made a confession of faith, and Jesus said, upon that kind of confession of faith, believing that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God, I will. He didn't say Baptist will, okay? He didn't say Methodist will, nor Pentecostal will. He said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not overcome. And it also says, when the Lord returns, will he find faith on the earth? If you're here, he'll find faith. If I'm here, God help me that he finds faith in my heart and my mind. Forsaking everything else, I just trust him. In the good times, in the most difficult times that you can imagine, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of the world grow strange and dim in the light of glory and grace. He created the church, and he's coming back for it. But those who are the redeemed, now I'm not talking about everybody that's got the church name on the church roll, everybody that comes in and out the doors of the church, make sure, absolutely sure, that you know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Paul says, what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his soul? What shall it profit a man if he joins every church and does not know Jesus? Nothing. Make sure you know Jesus. Creation. He created heaven, the eternal abode, for those who believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Read in Hebrews. Read it in wherever. Revelation, the last three chapters, Jesus went. And I know it's a bad, terrible situation in the tribulation, in the great tribulation. But listen, God hadn't lost control. In his time and in his timing, enough. He is going to reign supreme. The church triumphant. We are come to an immutable company of saints. To God the Father, the spirits of the just who have been made perfect. To the church triumphant. Heaven, Jesus is going to prepare. Jesus said to those who are mine, I call them. Not just hearing the word, but the internal call of the Holy Spirit of God in your heart and in your mind when you say yes to Jesus. Somebody just shared with me this morning, since we've been at church, about their place and the times of their salvation experience. Listen, I talked to a lady talking on and she told me I had a bucket and I was going from my house down to the stream to get water for the family. And she said the Lord was speaking to my heart, and I set the bucket down and kneeled down by a stump and talked to the Lord and was saved right there. I've heard people say I was in a motel room and I was drawn to read the Gideon Bible that was there, and the Lord saved me. Talking to a man yesterday, he called me on the phone. He said, "Jerry, where are you preaching?" I said, "It's Isabella Baptist Church right now." He said, "I spent some time in Isabella, down the road from the church, in a block white house." I said, "Okay." And he's preaching the gospel now. And I think all of you know the block white house down there is where they used to lock the doors. God is going to prepare a place for us. Every promise that Jesus has ever made, he will bring to its fruition, to the completion. He shall not fail, he shall prevail. Okay, I've got the coast territory here. And he says here, that's the positive side. The negative side, not anything was made that was made without him. Man invents, man discovers, man uncovers, man fabricates, man assembles, put together, but only God makes, creates. You know, all we do is work with what God has already put here. God is the only creator. Which brings to the reality salvation. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourself. It is the gift of God. Now, look at verse 4. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. In him was life, and life was the light of men. I read just a few days ago. When does the light of God come into a being? Just a few days ago, with this modern technology, they have filmed a sperm when it hits an egg, and at that instant, there is a burst of light. God is light. God is light, and in him, there is no darkness at all. We take, and you read and study the word, for light. Means to understand. We use the term, "I see the light." Means I understand. I see. When we see the light of God, we see the truth in the person of Jesus. And we embrace him as Savior and Lord. And it says, in him is no darkness at all. Now, darkness, the person told me just recently, "I don't like the darkness." I said, "Why?" "It's time to rest." She said, "No, there's a lot of unknown darkness. In him is no darkness at all." And in the Bible, when you study, light is a revelation of the truth of God. Darkness means they don't understand, they don't see. And much of the world, their eyes is blinded by the work of Satan, and they walk in darkness and do not know the truth. God help us to be a light in a dark world and send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore, and of course a lot of them Christmas offering across the world. Verse 5, it says the light shines in the darkness. And I thought about this. How can you illustrate light shining in darkness? And what crossed my mind, National Geographic, some of these deep caves in the earth. It doesn't matter how black the darkness. When you turn on one light, or when you light a match, or whatever, in the worst kind of darkness that you can think about, there is light. The light overcomes the darkness. Jesus Christ will overcome the evil in our world. Keep your eyes upon Jesus. Don't grow weary in the world that is so wicked. And don't grow despondent in a world that has gone crazy, as it were, and everything is against that which God teaches. Hide the word in your heart, that you do not be deceived. Hide the word in your heart. God wins. He will be victorious. Then the word at the incarnation. Verse 14. The word was made flesh, Jesus Christ. Eternally he has lived. And most all of us are familiar with the song Mark Lowry wrote, Mary, did you know? Jesus did not just begin to live at Bethlehem. He was just made flesh and dwell among us. And she delivered this child in Bethlehem. Sometime, the Lord willing, I hope he'll give me permission and I'll preach on the humiliation of Jesus. And then Paul said to the church at Philippi, the exaltation of Jesus. Just let me throw this out. Can you imagine speaking and the world coming into existence? You speaking and everything that is out there. And all at once you find yourself cramped in a mother's womb. Then all at once, the God of the universe finds himself wrapped up in tight clothes and laying in an animal trough. If he can humble himself like that, we ought to always be humble. We ought to always be humble. We just doves that God just put a special touch on. Isaiah said, Emmanuel, God with us. John 1 in chapter 1. This is what John said. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes and looked upon, our hands have touched and handled him, the word of life. In other words, John said, I've been there, I saw him, I talked to him, I've heard him, I've seen him. He is the word of life. Behold his glory at the transfiguration. Behold his glory. He's going to return in glory. And every eye shall see him. Yeah. We shall behold him, our Savior and Lord. Will we be here when he returns? Oh, he knows the answer to that. John says he's full of grace. He's full of grace and truth. Grace, marvelous grace. Grace that is greater than all of our sin. Grace that is abundant, whosoever will. Grace that pardons whatever the sin might be. I've studied the word, and I'm convinced the only sin that God does not forgive is unbelief. Whatever else, God is able. God is able. But he will not impose himself upon a person that refuses to believe. Restoring grace, thank you, Lord, for that. For redeeming grace, for amazing grace. It is amazing that God would love me. You know, I'm amazed. The love of God is graceful and lip or lung or tongue can tell. Lift up the Lord in a fallen and darkened world. You begin to lift up the Lord when you see your evil and you ask Him to forgive you and save you. Have you done that? Worship experience is great in this church to me. If you've got a good church home, this is a good place to worship the Lord. Thank you. Thank you, all of you, all that you do to serve Jesus. You're already part of the family of God, and you need to join a fellowship and put your unique talent, gift, work for the Lord. Here's a good place. What we're going to sing the invitation.